Farley. I work for the Alaska Fisheries Science Center. Oh. I work for the Alaska Fisheries Science Center. It's NOAA Fisheries here in Juneau, Alaska. And today I'm going to just briefly go over, can critical marine periods for Western Alaska salmon explain differing production dynamics? And I'm going to focus today on the Western Alaska chum salmon, which we understand have had a dramatic decline in production, in contrast to Bristol Bay sockeye salmon, which we've seen record returns. Okay, so when salmon leave fresh water, they spend their first summer at sea in the shelf waters of the Bering Sea. And this is an extremely critical period for these salmon. At this point, we call them juveniles during their first year at sea. And during that period, they need to be able to grow fast. And by the end of the first summer at sea, they need to attain enough fat reserves in order for them to have a higher probability of survival during winter. So again, this first summer is a critical period for them to gain size and fat in order to survive winter. So the focus today is on Western Alaska chum salmon and on Bristol Bay sockeye salmon. And there's a unique difference in the distribution of these two different species. The data that I have today are going to come from Northern Bering Sea. And in that region, the juvenile chum salmon that we catch are typically from Norton Sound and the Yukon River. And our survey data that we have indicates that Bristol Bay sockeye salmon are distributed in the Southern Bering Sea in the deeper waters of that region. So there's already, when we look at the, at least for the Yukon River and the Norton Sound stocks, there's a difference in the area that these fish spend their first summer at sea. And one of the things that we know for looking at salmon growth and fat reserves is it takes prey quality and quantity and sea temperature, which are all functions of how well they grow and attain fat. And this is just a diagram of what the typical Bering Sea food web looks like for juvenile salmon. And the environmental drivers here are sea ice. And we note that over the past few years, there's been a real reduction in the loss of seasonal sea ice. But also really important is sea temperature during summer. And so this just shows you that all these things impact the base of the food web, which are the plants, which then impact the zooplankton and the very prey that the juvenile salmon are feeding on. So I mentioned temperature as being important during the first summer at sea. So this is a time series trend of sea surface temperatures for both the Northern Bering Sea and the Southern Bering Sea shelves. There's a black line here. That dotted line is a 30-year mean. It's from 1985 through 2014 of the trend in sea temperatures. And then the red lines are the one standard deviation. But one of the things I want everyone to focus on here is we've got the Northern Bering Sea, which is the habitat that the juvenile chum salmon from Norton Sound and Yukon River are inhabiting during their first summer. And then there's the Southern Bering Sea, where we have the juvenile sockeye salmon inhabiting for their first summer at sea. And the time series that I'm going to briefly go over today for data that we have starts in 2003 and ends in 2019. But I think that what's really interesting is in both the Northern Bering Sea and in the Southern Bering Sea, there were these periods of relatively warm temperatures from 2003 through 5. It did cool off from around 2006 through 13, but then it got, as people know, very warm starting in 2014 and lasting through 19. And this pattern occurred in both the Northern and the Southern Bering Seas. So the data I'm gonna show are coming from integrated ecosystem surveys that we have been conducting from late August to and through September, from roughly 2003 to present in both the Northern and the Southern Bering Seas. Now, the reason we're out there in late summer is, again, because we're trying to understand how well fish grow or grew during summer and how much fat they attained during summer so that we can get a better understanding of how well they're going to survive over winter. And the data that we collect include physical oceanography. This is, as you can see on the left-hand side, there's a carousel there. There's a conductivity temperature at depth device in the center of that. We have an electrified cable. So we can put this device with all those gray, those are Niskin bottles. We can collect water. We can put this device in the water. We can see the temperature as this device is being lowered through the water column. And we can close those bottles at different depths so that we can get information on the plants and the nutrients at different depths. We also collect information on biological oceanography, which is the prey. This is the zooplankton. So this is the next level in the base of the food web that you see there in the center picture. That's a what we call a bongo net. It's got different mesh sizes. So we collect zooplankton. We fix those zooplankton, and they're enumerated in a laboratory later on. But I'm going to focus today mostly on our fish data. We use a rope trawl to catch fish. This rope trawl fishes from near surface down to about 25 or roughly about 90 feet depth. That's where juvenile salmon are located during their first summer at sea. We also catch a lot of young of the year or age zero pollock and cod, and we catch capelin and herring in this net. That's what you're seeing there is what's in the cod end. That's emptied onto that table. And then we sort through all those fish. We separate them out by species. We get the size of the fish. So we're collecting the weight and the length. We collect stomachs from the fish so we can get an indication of what they're feeding on. We take samples back to our laboratory so that we can get energy density. And I'm going to show you energy density slides. That's related to lipids. So this is how we understand how much lipid or how much fat these fish have prior to winter. We also get a relative abundance index. So I'm going to go now into just a couple of examples looking at the northern Bering Sea first. So this is where our juvenile chum salmon are typically located. Again, these are typically Norton Sound and Yukon River stocks. And I separated this out over our time series into the warm and cool periods. And one thing that's really striking is that from 2003 through roughly 2013, this is through the first warm and the first cool period that we had in the Northern Bering Sea, there was some variability in the relative abundance of juvenile chum in that region, but it's more striking to see what occurred when it got warmer up in the Northern Bering Sea. We saw a dramatic increase in the number of juveniles. Now, typically when we're looking at the number of juveniles, these fish are going to return as adults 2 to 4 years later. We can use this index of relative abundance to help us understand how many adults are going to return in the future. But as we know, even though we saw higher relative abundances of these juvenile salmon, the numbers of adults that returned were way below what we would have expected. So what went on? So looking at our fitness metrics for juvenile chum salmon in the Northern Bering Sea, remember they need to grow large during that first summer. And what we're seeing in these warm and cold periods is that these juvenile chums are larger in the warmer period than they are in the cooler period. However, what we were seeing in terms of their energy density, and this is related to fat content, to lipid, that there was less energy density for these larger fish in the first warm period, but we saw a real dramatic and significant decline in their energy density during this second warm period, which was anomalously warm in that region. And we look at their stomach contents, and so we know what they're feeding on during these warm and cold periods. Typically during the cooler period, they're feeding on higher quality prey, but this dramatic decline during the second warm period was likely due to the fact that there was an extremely high proportion of low quality jellyfish in the stomachs of these juvenile salmon that we saw out there. So while we know from our zooplankton toes that there were a lot of those low quality jellyfish out there, that probably helped them with enough of energy to put into growth, but there was not enough energy in these low quality prey to help them lay on fat prior to winter. So if we contrast this with what we're seeing in the Southern Bering Sea for juvenile sockeye salmon. This again is separated into the warm and cool periods. This slide is on the relative abundance. And for the first warm period, they were relatively more abundant. They did drop off in abundance during the cool period. However, we did see a dramatic increase, just like we saw for chum, a dramatic increase in the number of relative abundance of these juvenile sockeye salmon in our survey. Now, these juveniles are going to return 2 to 3 years after our survey. And so we expected from this increased relative abundance to see much greater returns to Bristol Bay, which obviously that happened. There's been record returns lately. And so what sort of metrics did we see for juvenile sockeye? Well, we're seeing, just like for chums, they're larger in the warmer years. But what we also saw is that their energy density was not as affected during these warmer periods. In fact, this is a preliminary estimate. I do need to do some adjustments. I just did this calculation last week. But even if that warm two period for sockeye came down a little bit, you can see that they didn't, that they fared better in terms of lipid content during that second warm period in the Southern Bering Sea than these Western Alaska chum salmon did up in the Northern Bering Sea. So that's just the highlights of what we're seeing at the end of summer. And we know these fish now, they're gonna leave the shelf waters and they're gonna move off into their winter habitat. And based on all the surveys that have been done in the North Pacific and some of the genetic work that's been done, this is the Western Alaska chum salmon ocean life history model that we know. And what we see is when they get done with their growth on the shelf waters of the Northern Bering Sea, they move off into their winter habitat, which is in the Gulf of Alaska. Now, again, these fish are going to remain out there for 2 to 4 more years. So in the Gulf, they move from winter habitat into the summer fall habitat into the Bering Sea, and they'll do that back and forth until such time that they begin to mature. And then they move back to through the back into the areas where the rivers to spawn as adults. And so what have we seen during this time period for this sort of shifts in the habitats from juveniles off into their first winter habitat? Well, we know that from our surveys that during this last most recent period, which is 2014 through 19, they had reduced fitness and lower fat, specifically lower fat content as juveniles. And then they left and entered Gulf of Alaska during the second marine heat wave, that 2018, 2017, 2018, 2019 period of time when the second marine heat wave took place. And one of the things to understand is if you don't have enough fat when you get off into winter and you enter a winter habitat, which is warmer, well, your metabolic rate is based on temperature. And so you're going to have a higher metabolism requiring more food. And not only that, when they enter their winter habitat, there's a great amount of increased competition because this is where Asian chum salmon stocks are also wintering. Gulf of Alaska stocks are wintering there. Pacific Northwest stocks winter in the Gulf of Alaska. So you have increased competition. And with this increased metabolic rate and extremely low fat reserves prior to entering, we think this had a dramatic effect on their survival and increased their mortality. If we look at the Bristol Bay sockeye salmon ocean life history, they leave the shelf waters and enter the area of the central North Pacific for their winter and spring. They do occupy the western part of the Gulf of Alaska. After that, they will move into the Bering Sea for summer and fall, and they'll do that, go back and forth between their winter and summer fall habitat for 2 to 3 years before they mature and go to spawn. But remember, we saw that the at least the lipid content was not as affected for these Bristol Bay sockeye salmon prior to winter. And in this area that they're overwintering, it was not as impacted by the marine heat wave. So these are the reasons why we believe that they were not as impacted for survival. So their survival was high. And we're trying to learn a little more about this winter habitat. And this is really exciting stuff. So we've been working with international partners through what we call the International Year of the Salmon. We completed a very large scale survey in February through April of 2022. This is the area that we occupied from the Gulf of Alaska all the way over to the central North Pacific. We had five vessels out there and we collected a lot of information and a lot of salmon during this winter period. What's also important to note is that we had other winter surveys that occurred during 2019 and 2020. The area that we occupied during those years was the Gulf of Alaska. It's shown there in that gray area. Now remember, 2019 was sort of the tail end of the second marine heat wave. And we know from our surveys, it was warm in the winter in the Gulf of Alaska. In 2020, it was not as warm. It was more normal temperatures. And in 2022, the temperatures were cooler. So we have three contrasting years of winter data. This is extremely important for us to be able to look at how fish were doing out there in this winter habitat. And so what we're going to be looking at here, and we've started doing this work, is winter fitness for, you know, looking at the stomach fullness and fat reserves that we see on these salmon as they're in their winter habitat. We are looking at their predators using environmental DNA. We don't catch predators with our nets. We're looking at competition, which means that we're going to be looking at the food web, diet overlap, and the relative abundance of the different stocks and the species that are out there, and distribution and migration using genetics and olothermal marks. We also, I just want to highlight a project that we just got funded through North Pacific Research Board 2210. And we're specifically going to link our summer data that I just showed you on the shelf with the winter ecology data that we've collected during these winter surveys to help us try to understand what's going on with Western Alaska chum salmon. So I have 20 minutes here, and this is just my conclusions. I just want to say that it looks like, you know, we've had some anomalous warming events in these regions of the Bering Sea, in the northern Bering Sea, that appeared to have a negative impact on the lipid content for Western Alaska chum salmon. These fish then left into a Gulf of Alaska during the second marine heat wave, which we think had a high negative impact on their winter survival. In contrast, we're seeing different indicators for juvenile Bristol Bay sockeye salmon, and they do not appear to be as affected by these anomalous warming events. Plus, they've overwinter in different regions, which also were not as affected. So I believe this is why we're seeing these different production dynamics in these two different species in relatively close proximity to each other in the Bering Sea. And last slide, just want to show this is the partners that we've been working with. We have others, but we can't do this without partners. And the collaborations help us identify where bottlenecks occur in our salmon life history. And these ocean surveys, as I've just shown you, are going to provide management advice and inform stakeholders on what's happening with salmon and what's going to happen in the future. So with that, I'll end. Thank you.
Ed, great job. Thank you very much. That was really informative, and I always enjoy your presentations. I'd like to open it up for discussion, but I do want to introduce my two co-hosts, which are Craig Chytooth and Harmony Wayner. Craig, would you like to kick us off with any starting discussion points?
Yeah, thank you, Ed. This is, I think, the second or third presentation that I've got to sit through, and I enjoyed every single one of them. This was definitely no exception. I think the information and the history of the information that was gathered is incredible and really, really useful thinking about, not only relatively near history, but setting a baseline or thoughts around the use and the intent of the information for policy and regulatory issues regarding conservation moving forward in both the state and federal fisheries. And that kind of segues into some of the discussion and information that I'm really interested and passionate about regarding salmon and sockeye specifically. I think I have one question two questions really. I really appreciated the compare and contrast for the Western Alaska chum and the Bristol Bay stock for sockeye. And my first main question, looking at all of the information that was provided during this presentation, And then some of my most recent food security, food sovereignty working group work, and then just engaging in the policy and regulatory world at the state level regarding Bristol Bay salmon in general. In October 2022, the last Department of Fish and Game did designate Chinook salmon in the Nushagak region of the Bristol Bay area as a stock of concern because we haven't met our minimum escapements for 5 out of the last 6 years. And it is very, very likely that Chum salmon is next on the chopping block regarding stock of concern designation at the state level, because we haven't met minimums in the Bristol Bay general, but specifically the Nushagak, where they're they're enumerated relatively well 3 out of the last 5 years. So we just have a couple more years to go, and then before our next regulatory board cycle, we're likely going to be facing some difficult policy and regulatory decisions. So that's question number one. Is this a compare and contrast? You know, I saw northern bearing chum stock with southern bearing sockeye stock, but then we have this interesting dynamic of chum and Chinook in the Bristol Bay region. We've had such amazing record returns for sockeye and very contrasting returns for Chinook and chum. So it's really impacting our subsistence ability and changing regulatory actions regarding subsistence in our neck of the woods. So that's question number one. Is just your thoughts on that. And then number two, I'm really happy to see parts of our research project, like Matt Jones and some of the other folks, Stanley Starkweather, Ohio, the dissemination and utilization of this information, I think, is really important. I loved your last slide and seeing all of the collaborators kind of getting an idea and a direction as far as what topics are important. I think my next question and last question, kind of leading and guiding this discussion from the Bristol Bay perspective, is where to work best with folks from NOAA and abroad on utilizing the information that is ongoing in policy and regulatory decision-making spaces that support self-determination for tribes. That's kind of my work, current and future work is going to be spending a lot of time basically organizing existing and future works from all of the latest and greatest information that Dr. Ed Farley creates year after year, and then utilizing that to share with policy and regulatory makers at that state and federal level. So if there are any recognized gaps or future needs on how to work best with you all and connecting that information to tribes. And then, just a quick overview of the compare and contrast for the different genetics that are happening in the Bristol Bay. We have amazing sockeye returns, but for the foreseeable future, it's looking pretty grim for Bristol Bay Chinook and chum salmon. And as our enumeration gets better and better, it's likely to, I don't know if it's going to help the situation any better, but we're looking for all kinds of science and observation needs in the Bristol Bay region. But all of your work out in the ocean is massively important. So thank you very much for your presentation, Ed.
Yeah, thanks, Craig. So let me see if I can address your first question on especially for Chum and Chinook and the Nushagak and the Southern Bering Sea area. So our surveys used to incorporate or at least encompass areas in what we call the interdomain, which is the more shallow regions of the Southern Bering Sea. Unfortunately, due to constrained budgets, we had to move our survey into the region of the Southern Bering Sea, which is known as the middle domain. It's the deeper area. What we know from our previous surveys is that juvenile chum and Chinook salmon, especially from the Kuskokwim and the Nushagak, are located in those shallow areas of the Southern Bering Sea. So it'd be in that northern region of the Southern Bering Sea. And so those areas, which are roughly about 50 meters deep and less, that's the same sort of depth and oceanographic processes that we would see in the Northern Bering Sea for those other, that's a very shallow area in the Northern Bering Sea. So I don't have any answers for you on chum because we don't have any data. Our surveys are offshore now, and that's where sockeye salmon are located. There, we find them from the 50 meter contour into the out to about 100 meters. So that area is very rich in, there's a lot of age zero pollock in that area. And in the warm years, that's what these Bristol Bay sockeye salmon are feeding on, believe it or not. and there's no limit to the number of age zero pollock that are out there for these salmon. So it's definitely different dynamic in the middle, in the inner domain, in that shallower water. That food web likely has changed. And so that may be the reason why you're seeing these declines in chum salmon. As far as Chinook, they're feeding at a different trophic level. They're feeding on other like capelin and sand lance and things of that nature. And when it does warm up, we are seeing less capelin in these regions. I'm not sure if that dynamic is creating any sort of food dependence or deficiency there. Again, we don't have any data. One of the things I will say is the Alaska Department of Fish and Game is starting new surveys in those regions this summer. And so because, you know, we're not able to do that, they're going to start doing annual surveys addressing chum and Chinook. So hopefully, you know, in the future, we might see something there. And then as far as your second question, you know, I think that one of the, we do have all these partners, and definitely we need to make sure that we're connecting in ways that are meaningful. One way to do that is just to get participation in our surveys by interested parties that want to see where we can connect. We're working right now on trying to get a better handle on whether or not our juvenile data can be used for a forecasting tool, but we're doing that through the University of Alaska Fairbanks. So this could give us a heads up 2 to 3 years in advance of what we're seeing in terms of the marine ecosystem and how that's impacting sockeye salmon production and what that might mean for future returns. It looks like there's going to be a positive outcome there from that. So, but we also need to make sure that we're connecting with the communities. So I always look for advice on ways to do that.
Well, I see that Julie has a question there too, specifically on the salmon, and she said she lost her voice, so I'm going to read it, and then I'd like to get back to maybe the improved community discussion and co-production. Julie says, you noted that Asian hatchery fish are having a dramatic effect on Western Alaskan stocks. Can you speak to that more if you know, and can you direct us to resources that further detail the impacts of hatchery fish on wild AK stocks? Like similarly, can you speak to the impacts of commercial fishery takes on Western Alaska stocks, that state and federal like prohibited species catch? And then adding on to that, can you talk about perhaps cumulative impacts, changing ocean conditions, commercial take and hatchery releases? Can you speak to it all, Ed? Or others if they want to jump in?
Well, I guess I'll go ahead and try. I mean, I said that one of the things that we're trying to understand is competition during winter, and the area that our Western Alaska chum salmon are utilizing during winter is also an area where Asian fish are utilizing winter. So that's why these winter data are so important, because we're working right now to try to get a handle on that. I mean, we have looked at 2019 and they're, but you know, that was the warm year. And so we're trying to incorporate some of this more recent data to try to look at what impact there might be. I guess I hope I didn't say they are having a dramatic effect. I'm saying that we know that they are out there at the same, in the same areas that Western Alaska stocks are. And if we are having a marine heat wave, there could be, because of increased metabolic rate and because of lower production of food during winter, there could be an interaction there. So that's something that we're trying to address. Okay, so you want me to speak to, I'm just a little bit up on the prohibited species catch. So if we think about, you know, the dynamics of prohibited species catch versus some of these changing ocean conditions, you know, we've lost hundreds of thousands, upwards of millions of these Western Alaska chum salmon. And my understanding is that, you know, in summer, that's when our ground fish fishery has prohibited species catch of chum. And from the genetic analysis that I've seen, it looks like, you know, they are catching thousands of, you know, of Western Alaska chum salmon. That's, and Western Alaska meaning that's Norton Sound, Yukon, Kuskokwim, and Bristol Bay stocks. So apparently they can't separate those out as easily, especially for summer chum. So they do catch Western Alaska chum, but we think that the greatest impact was on these changing, on survivals on these changing ocean conditions. And so that's I guess the message I would say there, and then perhaps the cumulative impacts of changing. Maybe I addressed that last question in all of what I just said.
It's certainly complicated, and thanks for sharing those perspectives based on your knowledge. I see that Craig has his hand up.
Yeah, thank you, Julie, for that question, and thank you, Ed, for your response. This is a perfect opportunity to just kind of ask and think about what observables and data gaps you think might be needed to address a lot of the questions and possibly the intent behind Julie's question. You know, one of my biggest concerns is a lack of resolution for coastal Western Alaska, for both chum, I mean, all the species in general, but it's thinking about subsistence needs and subsistence priority, and the cumulative impacts of both climate and commercialization. We have a lot of intercept fisheries. You can call them intercept, you can call them bycatch. And one of my biggest frustrations participating in policy and regulatory is that we have a lot of existing information and data that we could use and be utilized to make actionable stance or take an actionable stance on conservation for subsistence first and subsistence priority, and, you know, the surplus of salmon and sockeye and chum and Chinook. So I guess I'll get to the point here. We are seeing massive declines, and, you know, the bycatch issue is incredible. I think in 2021, at the state level, anyways, if we go back and think about where coastal Western Alaska chum are moving as they come out in the fall and summer, and then moving into the Gulf, and then moving back again as they are getting back to, or going back into their home tributaries and stuff like that. It's a limited entry fishery down in that neck of the woods, which for the month of June is a 98% intercept fishery. And they've done a lot of genetics, you know, waste, I'm sure is what you're referring to, Western Alaska stock assessment back in the early 2000s there. There's so much information out there. And what I find most frustrating is that we cannot utilize this information at a tribal level for conservation purposes. And what I'm trying to figure out and utilize better is the stance of the different tribes in the Bristol Bay region and the interior to support and bolster, resolution of genetics, better enumeration, and stuff like that. So think from Dr. Farley's perspective of what could be most useful to gain a better understanding of where these stocks are going. And I know it's difficult for science and research to take some sort of political stance on something, but you know, we have to be very intentional with the capacity at the tribal level of where we're going to invest our time and energy into. And if research isn't directly, I mean, co-produce number one, but if it isn't directly for some sort of purpose that has conservation in the regulatory and policy arena, it's really difficult to kind of extend our intimate network of folks that have a really good understanding of this space. Do you have any suggestions on somebody like myself who is kind of early career and getting into this observational world to support tribal self-determination? With your broad understanding of the genetics that move from Gulf of Alaska up into coastal Western Alaska and interact with all of these Asian stocks, do you have an idea or a suggestion on where to put time and energy to be most effective? On, you know, like, is there a group of people we should be reaching out to, like the food security, food sovereignty? Should we work with you more? Should we work with Alaska Department of Fish and Game more? You had made a suggestion about participating in these surveys. But yeah, I guess I don't know if that question makes sense, but there's just so much need and effort that needs to go into these to utilize the information that is created and what information or what direction from tribes might be most helpful for somebody that is looking to do future observational work in the Gulf, in the Southern and Northern Bering Seas, that the tribes can get behind.
Craig, so I guess we have a lot of data, like you just mentioned, and there's a lot of information out there. And so there's gonna be a lot of effort trying to understand some of the dynamics that you're just describing, because we're just getting into it. And I, you know, so there's 50 years of North Pacific Ocean data that we've now are starting to pull together into one database. This is through the North Pacific Anadromous Fish Commission. So, and I can say that just initial look at what we're getting out of that massive data set is a very good understanding of temperature preferences for the different species that we see. And this is, you know, over six decades of information. And I just had a little taste of what oceanographers can do in terms of modeling and oceanography and then looking at these temperature preferences and then relating that to what we saw for chum salmon distributions in the winter and also in summer. And I'll just say that, wow, it matches. And so, because we had some different dynamics going on, which I could probably explain to you in more detail at some other time. But, you know, my recommendation is, yes, please work. I'm here. I'm ready and willing to connect with whatever we need to do with the communities in Western Alaska to make sure that there's a way that we can communicate both on the Western science and from the Indigenous knowledge side, because there's a need for that. With our state partners who are now working their way into the marine environment, you know, this is something that's new. And so there's a way to connect there too. They're gonna be addressing specific questions, especially for the ones that you were asking me about, which is the Kuskokwim, Nushagak, Chum, and Chinook. So all I can say right now is, you know, we can talk more. I definitely want to talk to you more about this. This has always been something that I've felt really is necessary, because we need this two-way communication to make it work.
Well, and I mean, if I could build on that a little bit too, Ed and Craig and all, You know, I guess the from my perspective is that, you know, in the state of Alaska, two main points of like regulatory, you know, fisheries context is the Board of Fisheries and then that state, and then the North Pacific Fishery Management Council that's fed. And, you know, each of those has their own suite of processes on how they, you know, bring discussion points or regulations to the table during their meetings. And it seems like, you know, there could be a really good, perhaps, way to have some conversations to get this key, you know, joint state fed tribal community discussion to foster a little bit further. And I think it's like figuring out a best method, you know, to figure it out. I mean, I had the opportunity to sit on that. There's an Arctic Encounter Symposium like 2 weeks ago. And even like Doug Vincent Lang from the Department of Fishing Game for the state said that there is a lot of frustration just being a regulator in that context, like the state and the feds, and how do you do it? So I guess I think we should like challenge ourselves, not just Craig and Ed, to figure out a way to go forward. I know that, you know, Rachelle is on the line. So Rachelle, maybe some assistance to help us out to figure out how to foster this, you know, process and to make some like meaningful change and have multiple voices heard. I'm not asking you to come on the line right now, but like if you could, you know, help us. I know that there's a lot of salmon initiatives going on right now, tribally from the state and feds. And so how do we make sure that people are aware of what's going on, and then how to make sure that the meaningful points of the dialogue get carried forward in an efficient way? And Harmony, I don't know if you had anything you wanted to kind of add on.
Yeah, I think a lot of what I had to say has already been said, but again, I just wanted to say thank you for this discussion. And my main question was just, yeah, what's the best communication strategy to disseminate this information to communities? How can we build a structure that's already in, that we're not, you know, just fighting against the current management system and not really getting this work moving forward from the community level?
I see Matt has his hand up.
Yeah, thanks, Kathy. So Ed, you mentioned that you have a lot of data, and I was curious, yeah, I think you probably remember from previous work, you know, we tried to help compile Alaskan salmon data through the State of Alaska Salmon and People Project. That data sort of ends in roughly 2018, but there are many 30 and 40 year long data sets compiled through that effort. Can you describe where the data that you've collected are, how they're accessible, and how people could get to them, and what we might need to do to, you know, try to improve that situation? I know that there's another group in Canada, the Becky group, that's trying to look at basin-wide, you know, coastal impacts, and they're, I think, thinking of having salmon be a sort of target use case as well from a sort of Canadian organizational perspective, but it's a very different group of people from that are here today. I'm just curious, like, how can we share data and information across this whole community, and where do you make your data available? Thanks.
So our data are available through a number of different sources. There's a, yeah, it's an acronym, okay? It's called ACFIN. It's publicly available. Another acronym is ERDAP. It's through that process that our data are available. This is the data that I'm describing are the oceanographic data that we collect during our surveys, plus the fish information in terms of catch per unit effort and by species. There's also a connection with the Alaska Ocean Observing System, so you can go online. The data set is called BASIS, B-A-S-I-S, and it has all of our time series, I think all the way up through 20, I don't know if we have 2022 in there yet, but it's the most recent updates for all the information. We're required at the federal level within 1 year to get our data out for public consumption, and so we're doing that. So 1 year after we collect it, we have it all processed and ready to go. So you also said basin scale events to coastal impacts. I'm engaged in that project. That's part of PISCES right now. They're trying to develop a science plan for that, but it hasn't happened yet, probably by October.
Yeah, thank you.
Craig? I don't know if that's a remnant hand or a new hand.
No, it's thank you. I guess my last thought process on this, participating within our own project based out of the university, and then time spent as the IARPIC Indigenous Fellow alongside Harmony. Over the course of the last years, we've got a lot of tools in our toolbox for engagement. Thinking about the IARPIC priority areas for, you know, PA1, PA3. Let me look at that, my notes again. Community resilience and health and sustainable economies and livelihoods. So for all of the folks here that are, have IARPIC ties and connections, is to my hope and recommendation that come out of a lot of these, like this workshop in general specifically, or from those of us who participated during the workshop earlier this year, where we got to hear Margaret Rudolph's co-production of knowledge presentation, is that we continue to utilize this space to build up a community of practice around the message of equity and engaging with Indigenous communities and taking their guidance and leadership about research that needs to happen in their areas, because we have the tools in our IARPIC toolbox to really focus and hone in on community work, community resilience and health. I mean, we can't have community resilience or health without equitable access to salmon, or to have subsistence as a priority. We can't have healthy economies and livelihoods if we continue to lose essentially a property right, which is the state designation for a limited entry permit in the Bristol Bay region or other areas. We are in direct conflict with the commodified resources of pollock and other groundfish fisheries. So we have IARPIC, we have SAON and their guiding principles, which is so much is built around the idea of co-production, bottom-up, community health. We have a lot of tools in our toolbox to make this happen. So my message to the folks here in this room is really to lean in on that when we're thinking about proposals and where to start our work, building relationships at that community level, and leaning in on the guidelines from our Arctic research plan and guiding principles from the SAONs, the ANIONs, all the other acronyms of the world. And the last shameless plug really is around some of the existing work that I think our research project is doing is, you know, the COOBS RNA project based out of the University of Alaska Fairbanks, which Hayo is on the call here, who's the PI. Sandy Starkweather, who's also on here, is a co-leader in this research project. Our main focus is on equity. We're kind of looking to build a framework for ethical engagement for Arctic observations and just taking the lead from community members. So that's where all of my policy and recommendation requirements and questions are coming from, is that it has created, given me the opportunity to just participate in spaces that Indigenous community leaders are already participating in. And it's generally not really heavily, you know, academic. It is an the evaluation for a successful project is likely going to have some sort of community health or development criteria, workforce development, cultural subsistence. So like thinking about what the community needs and priorities are first, and utilizing all of the amazing leadership that has kind of got us to this point. And then kind of the intent, in my opinion, of these communities of practice through IARPIC in these meetings are for. So that's my shameless plugs and kind of recommendations from participating in a few of these workshops and meetings is we have so much opportunity for engagement and taking leadership from the Indigenous communities, just thinking about that relationship building first, and allowing Indigenous and local knowledge to kind of take the driver's seat and then participate in some of the amazing works that can happen from co-production and equitable engagement is what I'm looking forward to. And I think, Ed, the information that you have shared is really important. So making the connection from the tribal needs to information like Dr. Farley's, and then coming up with the strategic plan to actually utilize that in the policy and regulatory world, it's going to be really important. So that's my shameless, again, plug for all of our works moving forward. So thank you.
Yeah. Craig, thank you, for your insights today, and clearly, Ed, for your presentation and continued work as a salmon biologist and Alaskan. I know we have a couple minutes left, and we usually do team updates, but I see that Betsy Baker has raised her hand, so I'd love to hear Betsy's comments and then perhaps forego team updates unless we have a couple minutes at the end. Betsy?
Thank you, Kathy and Ed and Craig. This is a really helpful background for work that Ed Alexander and I have been starting along the lines, Craig, of what you discussed. And just wanted to let people know about that, probably more just through a post that I can provide after the meeting is over. But Craig, as I listened to your wrap up, I kept thinking of Nikusha's comments about flipping the script when she was presenting the U.S. Arctic Research Commission, the Arctic Research Plan. And I am wondering what this group could do to do that, to start asking the questions from the different perspectives with all of the good information coming into it. SEARCH has got a program that is equal numbers of Indigenous knowledge holders, scientists, and policymakers. So we are quite actively interested in all of the work that's been described here and would love to contribute what we're able to as well. Thanks.
Well, great. I see that Hayo made a post, and I'll just read it out loud for the group. He said, thanks for the great presentations and conversation and organizing this, for communication. Keeping international perspectives in mind may be helpful as well. For example, Japanese researchers are ramping up research in the Bering Sea related to salmon food availability, and he's keeping them in the loop and will share information on this meeting and other comms channels as well. So I just want to see if anybody else would like to offer any comments or thoughts at this point. I see we have a great diverse suite of folks online. Well, I'm going to say a big thank you to everybody for showing up today and with the intent to make a difference and an improvement in our communications, specifically relating to, salmon issues and Alaska Native community issues. So I'm going to challenge ourselves to remain engaged. We'll try to foster a little bit of this dialogue in the IARPIC web space, perhaps in an opportunity to talk about all the different salmon initiatives that are out there and then make some perhaps like networking and synergy connections as well. So look forward to engaging with you all on this topic again, somehow, some way, and really appreciate your time today.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ed.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ed.
Thanks very much.